Hello my dear friends, today we are starting our discussion on the second module of this subject. What we have learned in the first module makes the foundation of this subject compressible fluid flow. We have seen the basic concepts of the subject like Mach number, stagnation conditions, etc. Equations for conservation of mass, momentum and energy have been derived, and from those the expressions for steady flow energy equation has been also obtained. We have also discussed how the flow regime can be classified based on the Mach number and also seen the wave propagation pattern in all those regimes. And finally, we have derived an expression for the effect of Mach number on compressibility. This is the syllabus for your second module as per the APJ Abdul Kalam Kerala Technological University. In this module, we are basically discussing about the one-dimensional steady isentropic flow with variable cross-section. There are mainly four driving potentials responsible for property changes in a flow: variation in flow area, friction, heat transfer, and mass addition. In isentropic flow, the only driving potential responsible for the property change is the variation in flow area. Friction, heat transfer, and mass addition are assumed to be completely absent in isentropic flow. This module is devoted for the discussion on the nature of flow process and to derive simple algebraic equations of practical importance for steady one-dimensional flow. As discussed before, if the flow parameters do not vary with time, it is known as a steady flow. Along with this condition, if the flow parameters do not vary in the direction normal to the flow direction, it is also known as one-dimensional. The equations and concepts developed in this module are of great practical value in analyzing many flow situations, practically in duct flows where there is a gradual variation in the flow cross-section area. Nozzles and diffusers are the most common examples of flow devices in which the passage cross-sectional area changes in the flow direction. In such systems, the heat transfer may be considered negligible, and hence it is an adiabatic process. If the frictional effects are considered negligible, then the flow may be considered reversible and the flow becomes reversible adiabatic, or in other words, isentropic. The isentropic flow analysis can predict the real conditions and serves as a comparison with the actual flow problem. Hence, isentropic flow defines the ideal condition to be used for computing the efficiency of flow devices such as nozzles and diffusers. Let us start the discussion about one-dimensional steady isentropic flow with the governing equations. There are mainly six governing equations. Let us start with the continuity equation or conservation of mass. We know in continuity equation, it is said that the rate of change of mass within the control volume is the difference between incoming mass flux and outgoing mass flux. Or in other words, dou by dou t of mcv, that is the rate of change of mass within the control volume, is equal to m dot in minus m dot out, that is the difference between incoming mass flux and outgoing mass flux. As I have told before, we are only discussing about a steady process. Therefore, dou by dou t of mcv, that is for a steady process, we know the time rate of change of any property is equal to zero. Therefore, the term on left hand side, that is dou by dou t of mcv, becomes zero. Hence, the equation will be reduced to m dot in dot m dot out is equal to zero. Or in other words, we can say the mass flow rate rho ac is a constant. This is the first governing equation. The next governing equation is the momentum equation. We know according to momentum equation or conservation of momentum, the sum of forces is equal to the rate of change of momentum within the control volume plus the difference between the incoming and outgoing momentum flux, which can actually be read as sum of forces F is equal to dou by dou t of M into C within the control volume CV plus M dot C out, that is the outgoing mass flux, minus M dot C in, that is the incoming mass flux. And for a steady process, we know the first term on the left hand side becomes zero because time rate of change of any property is equal to zero in a steady process. And if you are neglecting the frictional forces as well as the body forces, this equation reduces to the famous and well-known Euler's equation, which states that dp plus rho c dc is equal to zero. So this is the second governing equation for one-dimensional steady isentropic flow. Next governing equation is steady flow energy equation, or SFEE. According to steady flow energy equation, the expression for stagnation enthalpy at 0 is equal to h plus half c square, which is a constant. So steady flow energy equation states that at 0, the stagnation enthalpy is a constant. Now coming to the next governing equation, that is derived from the second law of thermodynamics. The second law of thermodynamics can be written in the form of an entropy equation. This process, as it is an isentropic process, dS is equal to 0, that is change in entropy is equal to 0, or in other words, S is equal to a constant. So this happens to be our fourth governing equation. These four equations are the fundamental governing equations for isentropic process. In order to get a closed form of solution, the equations of state in algebraic form must be considered along with the fundamental governing equations. So the equation of state tells us that enthalpy H is a function of entropy S and pressure P. Similarly, density rho is a function of entropy S and density rho. So that's about the fifth governing equation, that is the equations of states. And finally, along with the above equations, the definition of Mach number is also considered for relating the flow parameters in terms of Mach number. So Mach number M, as we know, it is equal to C by A, where C is the velocity of the fluid and A is the velocity of sound. So it can be written as C divided by root of gamma R T. So these are the important governing equations for an isentropic flow process with varying cross-sectional area. Next, let us compare the isentropic and adiabatic processes for an expansion and compression. Let us start our discussion by comparing isentropic and adiabatic processes for an expansion process. We are showing the isentropic and adiabatic processes on HS and PV diagrams. The red one represents the isentropic process. We can see it is a straight vertical line, which means the entropy is a constant. The starting state is 1 and the end state is 2S. S stands for entropy, isentropic process. And the blue one represents the adiabatic process. Again, the starting point is represented by the same as what we given for the isentropic process. So the starting state is 1 and the ending state is 2A, where A represents an adiabatic process. Next, let us mark the values of enthalpies. H1 represents the enthalpy at state point 1. H2A represents the enthalpy at the end of the adiabatic process, that is H2A. And H2S represents the enthalpy at the end of the isentropic process, that is H2S. And H0 represents the stagnation enthalpy. We know the value of stagnation enthalpy is a constant according to the steady flow energy equation. Now, let us try to relate these static enthalpies, that is H1, H2A and H2S, with the stagnation enthalpy H0. We know stagnation enthalpy H0 is equal to H plus half C square. Let us start with the enthalpy at state point 1. We know H1 plus half 2,1 square is equal to H0. Similarly, for the next enthalpy process, H2S plus half of 2s square is equal to H0. And finally, H2A plus half of C2s square is equal to H0. So basically, we are relating the static enthalpies with the stagnation enthalpy. We know in a Mollier diagram, or the HS diagram, we can draw the constant pressure lines. Constant pressure at state point 1 is represented by P1, and the pressure at the endpoints of the two processes are represented by P2, then P01 and P02S represents the stagnation pressures at the corresponding points, and finally we can mark H02A. So this is about the HS diagram, or rather TS diagram. Now coming to the PV diagram, the pressure volume diagram. So the process, the red one again represents an isentropic process. One represents the starting state of the isentropic process and 2S represents the ending state. Similarly, the blue one represents the adiabatic process. One again represents the starting state and 2A represents the ending state. Corresponding pressures values can be represented as follows. This is about the expansion process. Now let us discuss about the compression processes. Again, we are starting with the HS and PV diagrams. So let us draw the isentropic process at first. So being an isentropic process, the entropy value remains a constant. So it will be a straight vertical line, starting point indicated by 1 and end point indicated by 2S. S stands for an isentropic process. Now the blue one represents the adiabatic process. Again, we are starting with 1 and ending with 2A. Now let us mark the corresponding enthalpies H1, H2S and H2A and also the stagnation enthalpy H0. Now we are relating the static enthalpies H1, H2S and H2A with the stagnation enthalpy H0 as we have seen for the adiabatic and isentropic expansion processes. So this is how we relate the static and stagnation enthalpies. And finally, we can draw the constant pressure lines on this Mollier diagram, P1 corresponding to state point 1, P2 corresponding to the end points and the stagnation enthalpies P01 and P02S along with the P02A line. So this is about the HS diagram. Next, we are going to plot the PV diagram. Okay, the red one represents the isentropic process starting with 1 and ending with 2S, and the blue one represents the adiabatic process again starting with 1 and ending with 2A. Now we are going to mark the two pressure points correspondingly. So this is how you compare an isentropic and adiabatic process for an expansion and compression process. Next, we are going to discuss yet another important topic in this module, that is the effect of area variation. In order to study the manner in which the area of a flow passage has to change to achieve the expansion or compression in a flowing fluid, when the entering fluid is subsonic or supersonic, it is necessary to understand the effect of area variation on flow parameters. The relationship between the change of flow area, that is dA, and the corresponding change in pressure dP, density d rho and velocity dc are obtained by combining the differential forms of appropriate governing equations. All these governing equations we have discussed before. Let us start with the continuity equation. The continuity equation says the mass flow rate m dot, which is equal to rho ac, is a constant. Now taking the logarithms and differentiating, we will be obtaining d rho by rho plus dA by A plus dc by c is equal to 0, our equation number 1. Now from the steady flow energy equation, we know stagnation enthalpy H0, which is equal to H plus half C square, is a constant. Now we are going to differentiate this equation also. So H0 is a constant, so we will be obtaining dH plus CdC is equal to 0. This is our second equation. Next, from the thermodynamic relation of perfect gases, we can write TTS is equal to dH minus dP by rho, where dS is the change in entropy, dH is the change in enthalpy and dP is the change in pressure. For an isentropic process, we know the value of dS, the change in entropy, is equal to 0. Hence, this equation reduces to dH is equal to dP by rho. This is our equation number 3. Now, let us substitute the third equation, which you have just obtained, in the second equation. The second equation is like this, dH plus CdC is equal to 0. So we are going to substitute the variable dH here. And we will be obtaining dP by rho plus CdC is equal to 0. Or dC is equal to minus of dP by rho C square. And this is our fourth expression. Now let us substitute this equation in the first equation we have obtained. The first equation was the differential form of continuity equation as this. So let us substitute the last term dC there. So we will be obtaining d rho by rho plus dA by A minus dP by rho C square is a constant. So let us rearrange such that dA by A goes to the left hand side. So we will be obtaining like this. And next, one more rearrangement is done so that the term dP by rho C square comes outside the bracket. So we will be obtaining dA by A is equal to dP by rho C square into 1 minus C square into d rho by dP. While deriving the velocity of sound in last module, we have seen the value of A square, the square of velocity of sound, is equal to dP by d rho. Hence, the change can be made here. And finally, we will be obtaining dA by A is equal to dP by rho C square into 1 minus m square. This is our equation number 5, and this is one of the important outputs of this expression. Next, we are deriving two more equations from this equation. We know from the fourth equation, dC is equal to minus of dP by rho C, or dP is equal to minus rho C into dC. Now, let us substitute this expression back in our equation number 5. So, we will be obtaining dA by A is equal to minus rho C dC divided by rho C square into 1 minus m square. And we know after rearranging, the expression can be written as dA by A is equal to dC by C into m square minus 1. This is our equation number 6, and this is the second output of this derivation. We know from the velocity of sound expression A square is equal to dP by d rho, the term dP can be written as A square into d rho. Now we are going to substitute this expression into our fifth expression. As shown here, this is the fifth expression. We are substituting the value of dP in this expression. And hence, we will be obtaining dA by A is equal to A square into d rho by rho C square into 1 minus m square. And after making sufficient rearrangement, we know C square by A square is equal to m square. And finally, the equation can be rewritten as dA by A is equal to d rho by rho into 1 minus m square by m square. And this is the third output of this derivation. So, these are the three outputs which we have obtained from this derivation. And as we can see, all these derivations have the term dA by A on the left hand side. And we are relating the variation in area with the variation in pressure dP in the first expression, and with the variation velocity dC in the second expression, and the variation of density in the third expression, that is d rho. Out of these three expressions, the first two ones are really important for our next concepts. Next, we are going to discuss the shape of a nozzle and diffuser. We know conventionally the shape of a nozzle is converging and that of a diffuser is diverging. But let us see whether it is applicable in all the conditions. We know nozzle is a device employed in flow passage to gain velocity increase at the expense of pressure. That is, the flow in the nozzle must be such that as it proceeds, the velocity of flow has to increase and simultaneously the pressure has to decrease. Hence, for a nozzle, dC by C, that is, the increase or change in velocity must be positive, and dP by P, that is, the change in pressure must be negative in the direction of flow. Now, these are the two important equations, as I have told before, which we have obtained in the previous derivation. Let us see how these equations work out for a subsonic flow. Since the flow is subsonic, Mach number m is less than 1, and also m square will obviously be less than 1. And the term m square minus 1 in equation A will be always negative as the value of m is less than 1. Hence, to achieve a positive value of dC, which means an increase in velocity, or a negative value in dP, which means a decrease in pressure. And we know both these are the characteristic of a nozzle. The value of dA according to these two equations must be negative always. So the flow area has to decrease. So the passage must be of converging shape as shown here. So this is a converging passage. Now let us see how these equations work out for a nozzle in a supersonic case. Since the flow is supersonic, we know the Mach number m is greater than 1 and the value of m square is also greater than 1. So the term m square minus 1 is always positive. Hence, to achieve a positive value of dC, which means an increase in velocity, and to achieve a negative value of dP, which means a decrease in pressure, the value of dA in these equations must be positive. So the flow area has to increase in the direction of flow, and hence the passage has to be diverging. So here we have to understand, even though it is a nozzle, for a subsonic inlet, the passage will be of diverging cross section. This is very important. And now let us see how this equation works out for a sonic flow. In sonic flow, we know Mach number is equal to 1 as C is equal to A, and both these equations require dA to be 0, which means At the location where Mach number becomes unity, the area of passage must be minimum because dA by A or dA is equal to 0. Now, let us discuss about diffuser. We all know diffuser is a device employed in flow passage to gain pressure increase at the expense of velocity. That is, the flow in the diffuser must be such that as it proceeds, the pressure of the flow has to increase and simultaneously the velocity has to decrease. Or in other words, for a diffuser, dP by P must be positive and dC by C must be negative. Now, these are the main two equations on which we work out. Let us discuss about the subsonic flow initially. Since the flow is subsonic, Mach number is less than 1 and m square is less than 1. And also, the term 1 minus m square in equation B is always positive. Hence, to achieve a positive value of dP, which means to achieve an increase in pressure, or to achieve a negative value in dC for equation A, the value of dA must be positive, which means the flow area has to increase in the direction of flow, or in other words, it should be a diverging passage as shown here. Next, let us discuss about the supersonic flow. In supersonic flow, we know the Mach number is greater than 1 and term m square is also greater than 1, and obviously 1 minus m square is negative. Hence, to achieve the positive value of dP, which means to increase pressure, and to achieve a negative value of dC, which means to decrease the velocity, the value of dA, the change in area, should be negative. So, the flow area has to decrease in the direction of flow, and hence it has to be a converging passage as shown here. So, we came to know that for a supersonic flow, the conventional shape of diffuser and nozzle has changed vice versa. And hence, we have seen how the shape of a nozzle and diffuser varies for a subsonic and supersonic inlets. Now, we are going to discuss yet another important topic in this subject, choking. We know in a diverging passage, the subsonic flow is decelerated towards zero velocity, while the supersonic flow is accelerated to its maximum isentropic speed. You know, the expression for maximum isentropic speed is equal to root of 2H0, where H0 is the stagnation enthalpy. The converging passage accelerates a subsonic flow towards sonic velocity as well as decelerates the supersonic flow to again the sonic velocity, that is m equal to 1. Now, if you take the case of a convergent-divergent passage, the Mach number may become unity where the area of passage is minimum. That is, it may be either by accelerating the subsonic flow in the converging passage or by decelerating the supersonic flow in the diverging passage. In both these cases, the Mach number reaches unity only at the trough. We know the trough is the region in the convergent-divergent nozzle where the area of cross-section is the least. So at the trough, the device allows the maximum mass flux it can pass, and this condition is said to be choked. For choking, we represent the properties with a suffix star, that is, pressure will be marked as P star, temperature will be marked as T star, and density will be marked as rho star. And that's all for today. So today we have started a new module, that is the second module, and we have discussed the important properties of an isentropic flow with varying cross-sectional area. We have seen the governing equations. We have also seen the effect of area changes on Mach number for a nozzle and diffuser. And finally, we have seen one of the most important topic, that is choking. I hope you enjoyed my class. Have a nice day. Thank you.